pessoa é de origem russa, então tem uma formação diferente da praticada nos Estados Unidos. E ela começou a ver que a educação americana tem falhas também, né? Era deficiente em muitos aspectos. E como em toda parte, ninguém consegue resolver os problemas de uma maneira geral. Você não vai resolver o problema educacional dos Estados Unidos, nem vai resolver o problema educacional do Brasil. Então a decisão dela foi criar uma escola, essa nova escola, que existe há 14 anos e que desenvolve atividades extracurriculares. Então, basicamente, é tentando desenvolver o interesse de estudantes, de crianças que vão desde 5 aos 15 anos de idade, não só em física, matemática, ciência em geral. E eu como os conheci, meio que causalmente, não sabia que ela tinha essa escola nem nada, e achei que era uma oportunidade muito boa de trazer ela aqui para ela falar da escola e das atividades que eles desenvolvem. So I, Marina, I made a big introduction to tell you to tell them about the school you created, the background.
We got school and the school.
Yeah, the background you have from Russia, the difficulties you face in the U.S. Usually people in Brazil think U.S. is the best. No. I'm telling them this is not the case. No. And it's important that you tell us your experience and tell us about your new school.
Okay, thank you for the introduction. So I'm really privileged to be invited to speak here. So you will see from my experience from the next slide that I came to education from science. So it's not so many talks, it's just this one, it's MB3. So this is a little bit about me. So you will know that I did have some experience in education. So before I go here, this is exactly how it happened when we came in the U.S. We didn't have kids at that time. My husband went to graduate school and I went to be a postdoc, to get postdoc training. And then a few years later, in Boston, we had kids, or two girls. And a few years later, when I started to look around for schools, we just realized that it's not education, it's like a joke from our point of view. And then probably we'll go to any country and we will listen to any parent and they will say the same, that what kind of education our children will get from the school. So we decided to take matters in our own hands, and because like our family and many other Russian families, they were mostly scientists, we decided to open a program, like an enrichment program, which would meet only once a week on Sundays, and we will train our own children. But we know that it's not easy to teach your own children, so we decided to call and accept more kids, so our children would not feel like they're unlucky. So the school was open in 2004 with only 4 subjects, and physics was one of them. So we had math, physics, we had Russian language, and we had art. So basically, how we come up with this, it's all came from our Russian experience. And this is the first thing I will talk about. So like, for example, when I was in middle school, it was a long time ago, when I was in grade 7 and 8, I would go to university and they had something like junior academy. Like once a week, we had lectures by faculty, and after that we had some, if it was biology, we had a labs, if it was math, we had like seminars with regular students. So I did that for 2 years. Then in high school, so I'm not from Moscow, I'm from city, which from Siberia, very far from Moscow. So we don't have such resources like Moscow has. So if Moscow has like 10 my schools, we had just only one class for the entire city, like 1 million people. So I took exam to become a student of this class. So last 2 years of high school, I was a student of specialized class in math. And also, we had summer schools, we had hospital schools, and I've got my master's degree in physics and physics education from that city in Siberia, then in biophysics from the same city. And then when we came here, I did see postdoctoral training at University of Illinois, Harvard Medical School, Stony Brook University. And finally, we opened the school in 2004 when our kids were like 4.5 years old. So I just wanted to let you know that the problem with education, with formal education, is not recent. Like second century before AD, it's already Marcus Aurelius told that good public schools hire good private teacher and accept the resulting cost as money well spent. So that was almost 2,000 years ago. So the more things change, the more they stay the same. So education, school education, is a huge industry. So in US alone, it's like $1 trillion industry. A lot of people work and trying to improve it and trying to write good textbooks, make good assessments, and so on. Education is a crisis. This is the debt that is spread out across many, many countries. And if you will read this, it's like, it's true that national educational system had always seemed tied to a life of crisis. Each has periodically known that a shortage of funds, teachers, classrooms, teaching materials, shortage of everything concerns students. And actually, it was written in 1968, 50 years ago. So 50 years ago, the Institute for Educational Planning in UNESCO said that the world educational system is in crisis officially. So we all know that none of the schools, doesn't matter private or public, big or small, can actually be like suit every single child. The children are very different. Also, to make big change, like training teachers, write good textbooks, prepare good assessments, and so on, it takes years, it takes a lot of money, it takes a lot of energy, methodology, legal resources. There is another way, which is kind of, so no one estimates how effective this is, but because it's not so difficult, it doesn't take so many energy and resources, and it's right here, so a lot of countries and a lot of people do different kinds of education. So I will, like, in my talk, I will overview, like, review the main types of digital education. And what I like about digital education, personally, that it doesn't include formal setting at all. And the people who teach children doesn't have to be certified. They doesn't have to have experience in teaching, nothing. They just have people know, for example, physics. So, like, for all those programs, doesn't matter math or science or art, the teachers who teach students, they don't come from educational experience. They come from, like, from professional experience. This is what they do for their life. So they don't teach, they do research. They are like artists, they present. This is what they do. And actually, when I was preparing for this talk, I found a really good paper last year, published last year in Brazil, Journal of Physics Education. Okay, so how do you define enrichment? So enrichment is actually action or process of enriching in various senses as a condition of being enriched. Where to enrich means to make richer in quality or to enhance excellence. So simply enrichment may be defined as an experience that replaces, supplement, or expands instructions beyond the normally offered by the school. This is just like summary, and it was done about math. It was done by a very famous scientist in education who works in Cambridge. So basically, why enrichment? That's what. Because you can. It doesn't matter, like, for example, I'm not sure how it's here, but in the U.S., you go to school where you live, if it's public school. And if it's private school, you can drive some distance, but still it should be around the place where your house is. So enrichment, it could be online. It could be anything. People who are coming from our school, they, because it's once a week, some of them drive 2 hours one way to get in our school. And it's also a good way, because people who are teaching, they are very passionate about the subject. So it's a good way to promote other subjects, promote physics, promote math. And of course, it's best way probably to support special educational needs. It doesn't mean only remedial education. It only means that education for gifted children or education for children who, like, not the same, like, unusual in regular school environment. Tell first about our Russian experience. Then I will give you programs for gifted and talented in the U.S. and few things about other programs for enrichment. And then give you some enrichment program in Switzerland. And then school global. So Russian experience. What? So Russia always had. I said this was even before revolution, because it started from a mess, because mess, scientific school was very, very strong in Russia. So they're not just did research, they also work a lot of with students. So in Russia we have a lot of some specialized selected classes and schools. It could be in language, in math, in science. And of course to get to the school you have to take exam. We also have, it used to be not so many, but now it's like a lot. Summer and winter math science school. Most of them are organized by university faculty, researchers, and graduate students. There are also basically like every single top universities have junior academies. Also organized by university faculty. Students can come there for some classes, or they can get some problems materials by mail or by knowledge by computer. Also competitions. Again, I forgot to check out the situation here, but in Russia and in many Eastern European countries, this is a huge, huge pyramid. So basically, every single student, every single school participate in starting grade 5, participate in all subject competition, math, physics, history, biology, geography, literature, English, and then, so first it goes on the your district level, then winners will go to city level, then they will go to some like few cities level, then it will be a republic, then all 15, it used to be 15 republics, would go to all Soviet Union competition, like, I mean, winners every time. And in the end, from the all Soviet Union competition, they choose 7 people in each subject who would go to international math, physics, chemistry, so competition. So it's a long way. It takes like they start in October, and all those competition goes all the way until April. So some people like Sasha Ivanov, who did this talk before, he did this way a few times and ended up in the international team for physics, but I stopped long before that. And also correspondence schools is the schools who send materials over a set of problems like every month, every week. So you solve them, you send them back. They have a lot of students who would, like undergrad or grad students, who will grade it and put some remarks and send you back to him. Okay, so what US has? So one of our daughters was kind of diagnosed, they were like gifted and talented. So that's why I learned a lot what's going on about this education in US. And actually some things I like very much. None of them comes from government. So none of them federal, none of them state. So all of them independent non-profit or profit organizations. So some of them well established and old. Some of them must come up now, but almost none of them are federal. So there's first of all a telechurch. I'll show you later. Then year-round programs, summer programs, competitions, also specialized schools, and also correspondence program. Okay, this is a telechurch. It appears that all U.S. divided parts between 4 different centers who are doing, like, they basically throw the net. To every single school, they kind of, it's well, very well known. It starts grade 2. You can take exams online. 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, almost every year. They have program for everything. And you can be checked in math, or math in English, or just English, and they would tell you, okay, you are gifted in this or this science. Okay, it doesn't matter that it's gifted. They just allow you to take some classes. Most of them you have to pay. Not much, but still, if you take a lot of classes, you have to pay a lot. example, our division so we live close to New York, so our was John Hopkins, yeah, Center for Talented Youth, John Hopkins University. So that center was founded back in 1979, and basically searched for bright children, or for motivated children. And because it's most of it's online, they have summer program and something like that, you can live anywhere and participate in one of those. Do offer a lot of summer programs. This is 3 weeks program. We have a lot of friends who been there. We never sent out offers, but we heard a lot of good things about that. They also have a lot of online programs. Some of them can be even take towards a credit in high school, if your high school would accept it. But the CTY, they're accredited to provide some accelerated courses instead of high school courses. And they also have weekend program. Okay, so briefly, as a regions, the built university, they just have entrance in grade 4, 5, and grade 7. Northwestern, they do all grades from grade 3 to grade 9, and Rocky Mountain still search all the grade 3 to grade 9. So other programs for gifted and talented, it seems like an enrichment program. It's organizations dedicated to supporting nations for talented people. So this is the Robinson Center for Young Scholars and Davidson Institute for Talent Development. They are very well known. Then the program with support research and programs which support networking between students, parents, teachers, like all specialists who work in education. And also MESS circles, which actually international organization. It exists in many countries. And out of problem solving, I think it's only US. And also the specialized publications. Okay. And this is like all types of management education which exist in US. So the first one is supplemental educational problem, and that was is usually based at school, teach by teachers, free for the student who lives in the school district, and it became so it came to existence after this No Child Left Behind in 2001. So the next one is pre-college programs, and this is a programs, they're very, very expensive. It's usually like 5, 6, 7 weeks programs for high school students, mostly organized by Ivy League and top private universities. And basically what you do is you take classes which are almost undergraduate classes. Then there are programs for gifted talented, as I said. Some programs exist in school district. For example, in our school district, we were happy and lucky that we had that program for intellectually gifted children in elementary school. And then what Sasha Ivanov was also talking about, there are research programs. So some of them, it has a long summer program of like 6 weeks. Like, for example, REU, it's very popular, it exists in many universities, and this is a huge experience for undergraduate and high school students. It's actually very, very intense and advanced. Another very famous thing is RSAI. It's a huge science institute based in MIT, where they accept only 70 international students from everywhere. And so 75 students live there for 6 weeks for free. So it's free of charge. There is also a program which is not free, promise it be you. It's also a huge program, 6 weeks program. And as I said, correspondence program and schools. This is just examples of one of the most famous institutes for gifted. They have summer program, which is, has like big geography. It's actually like coming from Amherst, Princeton, to Berkeley, Los Angeles, Austin. So they have branches in many, many places. They also have day program, which of course is more local. And the summer program, most of them for middle and high school, and day program, they start from age 4. There are also very well known summer camps, which are not very huge, but more like lecture, problem solving type camps. And most, so the best of them, and most important probably, at best camp, which is 5 week long summer program. A lot of great facilitators go there to teach. And then the same organization opened camp for middle school students. They also have this permit, so they have research and teaching part. And like 5-6 years ago, international math camp was open, so they have they alternate the location between France and Germany. 1 year in France, and another year in Germany. And there is a math camp for girls only at MIT. And this is also a good program in a higher state university. So those programs, they all happen during the summer, and they all mostly teaching. So it will be like university faculty would come to give, to provide lectures. The high school student would stay with undergraduate students, and they will just have classes, solve problems, make projects, and like 5-4 weeks. We have science competitions. So one of the most popular is Intel. So they also exist for 60 years. But the problem with all those competitions, you have to know about them. So many schools, it's free to participate, it's free to enter. But in most time you need supervisor. And your school should provide this information. I'm afraid that many schools just don't participate, not because they cannot, they just don't know. So another competition is for inventors. this is actually really, I never heard anyone who participated in this, but it's from kindergarten through the college. I'm not sure what they're doing there. And this is a Siemens competition, which is also very, very popular. Mass competitions. Okay, so it looks like there are many of them, but actually not. So the only competition which is like almost the same that, like in Russia is ABC 8, ABC 10, and 12 and 8. This is American Mathematical Contest, and it's administered by American Mass Teachers. And based on that competition, our student will be qualified for American invitation examination, and then go to America, this Olympiad, and then International Olympiad. And as I said, international, so the one competition is goes by selection, and another one is my skin guru, and everyone can participate in this, but probably here you also have this competition. So special tools. I'm not sure that they exist anywhere beyond New York City. So New York City, mayor of New York City, I mean, in, I think, back in 1934, they decided to open schools which would be supported financially by city department of education, not by state, not by federal, by city department. So they're all public schools. They opened 9 schools, some in math and physics, and 2 in art and performing. So they still exist. So the one, you know, few of them you probably all heard about, like Stuyvesant or Brooklyn Tech or Bronx Science. You have to take exam to get there, and exam, like the competition they have, is probably like 100 students for one spot. So it's not easy to be there, not easy to get there, it's also not easy to be there. Because like everyone so smart around you. Catch Builders program, there are a few of them, but the most interesting is PRIMES, which was organized one of our good friends and famous mathematician, Pavel Tinkov, at MIT. And now it has their branches everywhere, even like Europe, everywhere. And this is like actually a huge project program. So it's 3-year-long after school program. And if you know like a lot of people who does that, could do that, they basically pair scientific advisor with high school student, and they both work, they could work years, they could work a few years on one or more research projects, and usually it is like real research. You can end up with publication, you can end up with nothing. So, a few years ago, they opened PRIMES USA. It's also a free program, but now it's like a distance, long distance program, so it's outside of Greater Boston. So, everything goes via Skype or. Next program is PRIMES Circle, it's only in spring term. and they also have collaboration, which I actually didn't know about. One of them is joint programming MIT admission, so they try to train underrepresented children so they have the chance to get to MIT. And there's a problem, joint program with art of problem solving. Okay, few words about Switzerland. It's all public data, so I know the person who writes this. I talked to him, but he sent me a link, so we discuss a little bit. So they also have few things. Everything also done by university faculty and based on the university. So students come to the campus. So the one is best scope. So it's out of school place where they offer some activities, experiments, games, math games, and so on. The MS Club. So that's what they do. They're solving Olympiad-style problems, usually with graduate students. Youth Academy is basically the same what I call Junior Academy, but in Russia. This is regular weekly classes. Now they also have earlier course and EPFL, which offer accelerated and more in-depth school program to talented children. And they also now have Prime program in collaboration with Boston, with MIT. And on top of everything, they even have semester-long program, which is basically allow a high school student to participate in the University of Geneva class during one semester. Okay, so that was about a little bit about Russia, United States, and a little bit about Switzerland. Are there any questions before I will begin talking about my school? Statistic about what? Oh, no, no. Actually, I don't have statistics. I heard a talk that people have been trying to get statistics about gifted and talented. So how many of them after they went through all the special education, does it increase their chances or probabilities that they will go to science compared to those who never been exposed to any of this? Okay, they claim that it's like almost no difference. So like if you, but what is the saying? Saying if you have higher Q, then you have higher Q. Because if you don't tell and get, say, taste based on IQ. So I would expect much bigger difference for students who will not work with higher Q and don't have good schools. So like if he or she will finally get to some enrichment with a good teachers, they could get a lot, could change their life. Okay, so this is our school. So this is how our web page and everything. So we have few. I would tell first about our vision. So when we decided to open the school, because all of us scientists, we love to talk, to discuss, to argue. So there were a lot of talking, and finally we decided kind of main principles what we want to achieve. So of course the first what we wanted to inspire. Then we wanted to create a special environment for children and then simply help them to acquire some special skills of independent reasoning, complete some knowledge, and so on. So this is how we decided to do this. We hired teachers who are highly qualified specialists in the subject they teach. Because it's like Sunday program, we call the school for motivated parents. Not every family would come on Sunday, every Sunday, to give some special additional education for their children. So basically people who come there, they're already motivated, and they're more like each other. It's easy for them to study than in the regular classrooms. It's also just crucial to have classes on the campus of a university where all those people come and go, where they sit in the regular classrooms and they know that next day students will come here to learn physics. So physics is important. And we also know, because we have such a great teachers, they can motivate students and they can give them a chance to learn faster and in more depth. So this is some brief history. So the current enrollment in our school is 400 students, and we accept students starting grade level H3, because we think this is a good age. They play, they have natural curiosity, they have great reasoning, and it's fun to work with them. And the school goes up to age 17, which is 1 year before graduation, because last year of high school is terrible. So the colleges and lots of girls. Most of our teachers are faculty from Stony Brook, Brookhaven National Lab. We have about 20 classes because we offer 11 levels of math. Then we have like 1 year of earth science, 1 year of science, and 5 years of physics. And this we actually brought from Russian system. And we think that physics is one of the few sciences which cannot be learned in 1 year in high school. So you have to live with those concepts, you have to accept them. So we start physics from grade 6 and go like 5 years of physics. We also have languages. Host competitions, all of them, and even the final physics. This is the only one we found which is possible for our students to participate, but there are very, very few of physics competitions. Then French competition, Russian, and 2 years ago we also opened clubs, which mostly about problem solving. also that we are unique because a lot of, not a lot, but few of the programs exist in Russia. They just combined experience of other schools and other people. But after 14 years, I would say I still sure that those few principles are very, very important. And I think this is the way how university faculty, graduate students, and even undergraduate students can help, can transfer the passion about physics, can transfer the knowledge, and because and help to extend the physics knowledge and interest among many, many other people. So it doesn't matter where they live, it doesn't matter if they like you as a physics teacher, if they can reach Lion or program in the college next to them, they can take classes to be, it will be enough. It's more than nothing. And I have like very short movie about our school.
Started 11 years ago with just 60 kids, and now has a constantly growing enrollment of over 300 students plus a waiting list. There are a couple of main distinctions between School Nova and many other enrichment programs for school kids. Most of the classes in math, physics, and science are taught by real-life scientists, professors, and researchers from Stony Brook University and the faculty of Brookhaven National Lab. Many of them have been with the school from its inception.
Students at school are typically much more motivated, they are much more interested in the material, at least if I compare them to typical college one students.
The program is so well run. We are so much ahead here than the kids are in regular school. I believe that it will help me learn more material that I wouldn't always be learning in school.
I thought it would be fun and interesting, and we get to do a lot of experiments. The teacher and the students are great, and we made a lot of friends.
Although I take math clubs and math class, there are competitions that School Nova holds, and actually the math clubs can help you train for them, and it's fun to solve math problems.
I like the approach. I like the way the math is taught, and that I can be involved as a parent and help her with her work.
For my son, who's a very advanced student, not just the competition and contest, but just the investment in his entire future, I feel makes this program the best on Long Island.
Math and physics were at the roots of the school program, remained its main staples. The school follows the tradition of Russian math and physics education, leading to its strong appeal.
I like school more because it's opened the world for my son to many educational opportunities, especially in mathematics.
But the school is not just about math and science. From the very beginning, the school offered classes in language and art. Alongside the advanced English, there are classes in Russian, French, Spanish, and Italian.
Well, I'm a French citizen, and I'm happy to share my love of my language with
years old. The oldest is 16.
Right now, you can stay at school for 12 years, and every year it will be a different program for you. Next level of math, next level of science, next level of language. Over time, we introduced more languages. We added chemistry, we added biology. A few years ago, we introduced a program in information technology, which turned to be a very successful one.
I take chemistry, physics, Russian, and
Spanish, math, French, and art.
Russian, math, physics, and biology.
I'm just taking IT and math.
I've been taking Russian literature, and I started physiology and disease in January of this year.
The school does not have any entrance exams. Everyone is accepted and placed at the individually appropriate level of the selected subjects. The school makes a focused effort to motivate its students, hosts a number of national competitions in math, physics, French, English, and Russian. And of course, there is graduation, the award ceremony. Yes, every year brings an extensive crop of awards, such as gold medals in the Grand Concours National French Contest, or top prizes in Math Kangaroo and AMC. And now our students at MIT, Caltech, Yale, and other top schools.
Overall, we are very happy, and we hope that the school will survive and thrive for many, many, many years so that we all can graduate and go to colleges from here.
I am very happy that my kids are surrounded by very enthusiastic, very creative and hungry for knowledge kids, and they're bright teachers, and we are going to this school every Sunday because we understand the power of all the knowledge. I think it's an amazing school.
Okay, if you need more information, everything what we do, it's open for public, and you can find it on our webpage.